It's fast approaching the end of the year and investors will soon be reflecting on how their investments have performed, as well as considering what changes to make to their portfolios. And included in these decisions will be what effect changes in the tax regime will have on investment returns and estate planning in 2013. Here to help us navigate these decisions is Sean Latta from Questra Wealth. Well, a lot of people are going to hit the grindstone and have a look at what returns they have seen over the last year. Sean, where do we start?
Well, I think, I mean, we all know this time of the year, people sort of catch their breath and hopefully start reviewing their portfolio, see what's happened, and maybe start taking stock. For me, when we're having a look at client-specific reviews, there's a couple of things that we look at. The first one is, has anything changed from a personal point of view? Okay, everything that we set up, and in fact any investment one makes, it's got to be towards some objective, and if somehow that's changed, we need to reevaluate that. So that's the one thing. We then start having a look at asset classes and perhaps more importantly the reweighting of those assets. So I think a lot of people should be sitting down at this point in time in the year and saying, first and foremost, how have the asset classes performed? And I've got a couple of figures here, which I must say, when I picked them up, interested me a lot. And secondly, how does it then play out from a portfolio point of view? When we look at asset allocation, we know that by far the majority of what determines your return is the mix of assets that you've got. So you don't want to be in a situation where you've had a strong run, like in the case of listed property, which continues to surprise. You've got year-to-date returns of somewhere in the region of 22%. Are you now perhaps sitting in a position where you're holding too much of that asset class that then you'd actually like to?
Sean, just give us a rundown year-to-date. I'm very interested to hear what the asset class performance has been, because there's been so much pain and doom and gloom. Some of the analysts I've been speaking to recently, it's been almost a case of shh, be quiet, because we're actually enjoying a bull market. So what is the breakdown by asset class for investors this year so far?
Having a look at the firm figures I've got as at end of October, we're sitting, like I said, listed property 27%. The all share index at that point was just a touch under 20, 19.65. I think we're now in a situation that's probably closer to 21% as we sit at the end of November. The all bond index, 12%. The only disappointing number obviously coming out is cash, and the Steffi rate, sort of even in nominal terms, sitting behind what inflation is. So where a lot of people have been sitting in cash for certainty, the only certainty they've actually got is they've lost money.
Now, just to reverse this question around what we said in the beginning around, you know, looking at your investment portfolio and seeing if anything's changed. Often depressed, especially if you're a pension fund, depressed returns means that you might have to change your strategy. But what we're seeing at the moment is that the returns since 2007, 2009 have actually been pretty good. And in terms of your clients, I mean, with returns like that, does there really need to be any change in the strategy in terms of achieving a retirement savings goal? Based on what we're seeing from the returns point of view?
There's two things I think to look at there. From a rebalancing point of view, we don't do time weighted, so we don't wait to a certain point of the year to rebalance. So we're continually rebalancing from a value perspective. So there's no rebalancing taking place in the portfolios as we review, other than on a continual basis. What we do have, and what I do have in this, the case of a couple of clients, is because where we were a year or two ago, we needed to take quite an aggressive stance in terms of how much equity we took on. We're now so ahead of the market, we're on the front foot, and we're actually sitting down and saying, perhaps we can change our objective slightly and perhaps take a slightly more conservative view, purely because we've been put on the front foot.
In other words, reduce some of that equity exposure.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the growth
across
assets such
board,
as...
Across the board, Sean, or are you very specific in where you would reduce exposure?
Reducing exposure, I think, like I said, outside of the rebalancing, reducing the exposure for those clients that do now find themselves on the front foot and are close to retirement. Those are the ones we're starting to say, hang on a second, maybe let's take some equities off the table at this point in time. So where we were targeting an inflation plus 6 type number, we're taking it down to inflation plus 5 or even 4.
Hence
reducing the risk with a very, very similar outcome down the line in long term.
Sean, obviously a big demographic trend is that people are living longer. I wanted to just get a very sort of basic rule of thumb guideline for people that are thinking about their own investments at different stages of their life. How much equity exposure? We know equity is the one that can really deliver the above inflation rate returns. How much equity exposure does people in their 30s, 40s, and 50s need to have broadly when they retire, when they're planning on saving for retirement?
Look, I think as far as possible, and certainly if you are more than 10 years away from what you deem to be your retirement age, I think you want to take on as much of the equity market as your stomach allows. So it is a discipline issue, it is a behavioral issue. You've got to get past those emotional bumps and ups and downs. As you start getting close to retirement, you want to start bringing it down, but not too much. Okay, and a lot of people, I think, make the mistake of drawing a line in the sand from a retirement perspective and saying, I'm going to reduce, get to retirement, let's say even at 65, and still have a 30-year horizon in terms of investing. So I don't like to see my clients going anywhere below 50% from an equity market point of view, even if they're in retirement.
Just in terms of something you told me off air, which is that you don't use active fund managers, you only use passive strategies, whether it's in the unit trust vehicle or the exchange traded fund vehicle. I'm just intrigued to find out why you don't allocate any money to active fund managers.
Perhaps on that side, by far the majority in passive. I do still make some use of active where appropriate. But I think the evidence is becoming harder and harder and harder to ignore. And what I find is most clients that come to me are looking for one thing and one thing only, and that's certainty. And as a planner sitting on the outside with the range of funds available and with the evidence that's being presented, that to me is the most meaningful solution for
where them. Where you do dip your toe in with an active manager, where do you prefer the growth versus the value investment philosophy, or is it a mixture?
For me, it's very much value, and more specifically, deep value. And I think the reason for that is I find that to be a complementary style. There's a portfolio that I make use of, which is the Superdogs portfolio, which I think you've come in contact with.
And Cannon Asset
yes,
Managers.
We had Adrian on last Thursday.
Yeah. So
I hope he's watching.
I think from that perspective, what you find there is if you're going to go active, you don't want to be sort of exposed to the big names. You want to be digging deep. You want to be going into sometimes the mid and small cap range to really bring out that deep value bias and get some
of
get
that long tail
of that long tail where nobody else is looking. And I think there's still a lot of opportunities there. So where appropriate, we will add in that to complement the style. There's a couple of things. It doesn't have resources, which sometimes passive, that's chink in the armor, sometimes a little bit overexposed to resources.
Right.
It doesn't look at resources. Another chink in the armor says, well, it's going to be more exposed to larger stocks and more expensive stocks. And now we're saying it's going to be very cheap stocks and by and large, purely by default, smaller to mid-cap stocks. So you're getting a nice blend coming in there. And again, it's really around saying, where active management has a role to play, let's use it. Where passive has a role to play, let's use it. The debate that rages on between them, I don't think will ever end. It's about getting the best of both worlds, to my mind.
Okay, so just in terms of the exposure that you use to get to, say, a broad equity market like the JSE, you mentioned off air that you prefer benchmarking or using the SWIX index as the basis there. So I imagine the Satrix or the Standard SWIX product would come into it. Is that it, or do you use other ETF products, specifically smart beta products, and perhaps something like the Nedbank equally weighted ETF? Does that come into your thinking, or is it just the one product that you use?
It's the one product, and from an equity point of view, we're looking at SWIX. But I think to sort of complete the rest of it, it is a multi-asset class solution that we have put together there. And really what we're looking at is we want to track everything from equities to bonds to property to cash, and then also looking at that from a global perspective as well. And through that, having the right asset allocation that's going to drive that predictable and certain return over time.
How are you feeling about the equity environment right now, the state of affairs in South Africa and globally? We've been through a relatively, let's use the term, volatile year. Mm-hmm.
It has been hugely volatile, and you know, again, sort of coming back to some of the numbers that have come out, if we scratch below the surface of equities, you know, we're seeing a very, very confused market. Financials, 26% for the year, and industrial 29%, resources negative 5%. You know, so you have this very mixed bag of assets. And again, you know, we spoke about asset classes. Let's start having a look at what you have within a share portfolio.
Right.
you're probably going to find a lot of people very overweight in industrials that are now heavily priced.
And now thinking, what should we do? Do we hold on to these industrials that Warren and I debated all the time, or not?
Well, interesting, I mean, I saw some stats come out the other day, and just having a quick look at them, if you have a starting price of PE 20 for industrials, the following 5 years, history's told us, will give you 5% from a financial. The PE at 12, it'll give you a 12% return over the next 5 years. The resources, current PE of 11, history's told us, starting point of 11, next 5 years, 30% per annum. It's very, very difficult to ignore that, despite all the terrible news we're having in the mining sector.
So be brave. Dig deep into the resources environment.
It's difficult, but yeah, absolutely, absolutely true. I think the bottom line is, I think there's a lot of stocks out there that are perhaps getting overcooked, and it is giving the market this sort of bullish feel about it, and maybe it's incorrect. But I still do believe that given what we're seeing, a very confused market, are there stocks and are there opportunities out there? I believe there is.
Sean, before you go, I wanted to ask you on just a foreign asset allocation or strategy. How much you sit down with your clients and you talk about how much money you should allocate offshore, both to fixed income and equities. How do you think about that, and what's your take on how much does it vary between clients, and does it depend on the risk of the clients as well, the appetite of the client?
To a certain degree. For us, it's more around objective. So if I can clear two of the three things that we look at off the table and look purely at diversification, one I call a global investor, and there we're just looking at opportunities anywhere we can find them. Okay. The second is those that have got offshore liabilities we need to invest in and have a certain pocket of money for them over there. Looking purely at diversification, what we found is that if you're driving an objective, whether it's inflation plus 2, 4, 6, or 8, anywhere between 15-25% is going to be your sweet spot. So if you're only at CPI plus 2, you still need to have about 15%. If you're going all the way up to CPI plus 6, you're going to go up to about 25%. Anything over and above that, you find you're not going to get the type of return that you're looking for in terms of the inflation plus target. And it's better to then actually commit that locally.